Okay, so now you can see how a few businesses are. We got at least two of them more, so we have three of them. Simply interested. So four lawyers, right? What we try to do in not only the introductory part of mine, but also in the whole session, we have like three more speakers after me. It will last until 8 o'clock with one small break. Yeah. What we try to do is to have you think of the blockchain and Bitcoin and learn a bit about that, what it is. We give you further reading for the people that are new to the area. And for the people that are not new in the area, we want you to look into the connection between blockchain on one hand and legal on the other hand. And that's done via identity. So today I focus on that path. Let's say so blockchain technology, identity management technology, and then see what happens in the legal field. So if we manage to give you tools to study more on that subject after you've left here tonight, then we succeed. Okay? So what we do is we focus on cryptography this time. I won't be doing the normal regular introduction because I have a video that's better doing that. It's a 2.5 minutes video, and it's full of, and we showed the early people that were early, it's full of bullshit. So there's, and you have to find out where the bullshit is, where the faults are. And that's a good start. And then we take it through cryptography. We will give you the three building stones, not only of blockchains, cryptographically, but also the building stones of identity management. They're exactly the same. The only difference is blockchain is just a new kid on the block, and identity information systems were there for 30, 40 years. And it's interesting to see how you bridge that and how we can relate that to each other. And then we quickly become in the field of legal. So I have another question for you. I need that one.
Thank you.
I think it's out of focus. Yes. Yeah. Now I will work. Do you use your own Bitcoin Cash? If you don't know what it is, just answer no. People that answered no, if you had Bitcoin Cash, a Bitcoin already 3 months or 4 months ago, you should have Bitcoin Cash as well.
Yeah.
Because it's a fork of the Bitcoin. We won't go into forks today, but it's just a way of asking. Did anybody who said yes really bought Bitcoin Cash on their own without having Bitcoin? You bought Bitcoin Cash without having Bitcoin?
Yeah, unfortunately.
Sorry?
Unfortunately.
So you stepped in too early or too late or whatever?
Well, I bought after the fork, yeah, obviously.
Okay.
And now I realize that I'm just waiting to get out, but probably more I wait, I'm probably losing more.
Okay.
But I didn't buy much, so it was more like experiment.
It's still fair, isn't it, in price? It's still, it hasn't... degraded,
it's had a huge spike over the last couple of days. Yeah. Major
okay.
Spike.
Yeah, I think overall I think it went down
20%. You're not doing that.
It's not much.
So for the people that are new here, Bitcoin Cash is another example of a cryptocurrency that has a blockchain, and it has the same blockchain as the Bitcoin has. But there are many blockchains. Already like hundreds. Blockchains is a totally new technique, and it landed in this area here, right in the middle of all regulations. Because it's totally new, There is no specific regulation in place to regulate the real, let's say, innovative features and foundational changes it can it promises to bring in, and also the disruption. So the digital currency is not regulated, but on the other hand, there's many rules already in place that think that they can regulate it. But this is a dodgy area. Which words would you associate with blockchain at this time? So I know some people just have small information on it because they're new, like you. But anyway, I would like you to answer the question. What? How do you associate it at this time, at this point in time today? Hi, for the people come in, just your spots now. You can take chairs here as well. Trust is a very important one. The ledger. There's many films, simple films that explain blockchain. You will always see things like ledger. It's one big ledger worldwide, and also decentralization. So there's no third party involved to establish transactions. What are the typical legal words here? I would say trust, trustless. Any more?
Identity.
Yeah, identity. Immutable.
Safety.
Yeah. Okay, Bas, you could start in the film now.
Yeah.
About what blockchain really is. And again, be careful, it's full of faults. So please, for the people that know about blockchain, try to find out where the faults are.
Be stored. Facts can be verified by anyone, and security is guaranteed. That way, no one can cheat the system by editing records, because everyone using the system would be watching. Systems like this are on the horizon. Be stored. Facts can be verified by anyone, and security is guaranteed. That way, no one could cheat the system by editing records, because everyone using the system would be watching. Systems like this are on the horizon, and the software that powers them is called a blockchain. Blockchains store information across a network of personal computers, making them not just decentralized, but distributed. This means no central company or person owns the system, yet everyone can use it and help run it. This is important because it means it's difficult for any one person to take down the network or corrupt it. The people who run the system use their computer to hold bundles of records submitted by others, known as blocks, in a chronological chain. The blockchain uses a form of math called cryptography to ensure that records can't be counterfeited or changed by anyone else. You've probably heard of the blockchain's first killer app, a form of digital cash called Bitcoin that you can send to anyone, even a complete stranger. Bitcoin is different from credit cards, PayPal, or other ways to send money because there isn't a bank or financial middleman involved. Instead, people from all over the world help move the digital money by validating others' Bitcoin transactions with their personal computers, earning a small fee in the process. Bitcoin uses the blockchain by tracking records of ownership over this digital cash, so only one person can be the owner at a time, and the cash can't be spent twice, like counterfeit money in the physical world can. But Bitcoin is just the beginning for blockchains. In the future, blockchains that manage and verify online data could enable us to launch companies that are entirely run by algorithms, making self-driving cars safer, help us protect our online identities, and even track the billions of devices on the Internet of Things. These innovations will change our lives forever, and it's all just beginning. To learn more about the urgent future of the blockchain, please visit IFTF.org.
This is the credit accreditation or acknowledgement of the ones that made the film. So let's try to find out where the faults were. Anybody has an idea? Did you hear something that is not correct?
I think she said something like personal computers, family days.
Okay. Keep that in mind. Keep that in mind. Anyone else?
Receiving transaction fees.
Transaction fees?
Yeah, like when a transaction takes place, you are credited.
Okay. Okay, I didn't get that.
No, they said everybody validates and earns a small fee, and that's not the way it works.
Okay, let's see how it works. So, I have a few questions, like very direct questions to you, and you could answer them again using your smartphone. And for the people that came in later, you can go to www.menti.com and use this code. And then you can vote on the questions. So it's more or less a workshop. Yeah.
The only thing is I don't have internet.
Okay, but there's also a Wi-Fi here.
Okay.
And it's called Connected in A-Lab. It was on the first sheet, but
oh, sorry, I got it here.
Yeah, that's the one. Yeah.
Sorry, thank you.
Yeah. Okay, so this was an easy one. No?
Someone.
Or did people that
someone go against the grain? Come on.
Sorry?
Someone not follow the good.
Exactly. is somebody here that doesn't know what we're talking about? Maybe? Just put up your hands because we want to help everybody, of course. So it's indeed not software. So we go on to the next question. There was a statement, and maybe you could push this button, Bas, then this question is easier to see. Yeah. So the statement was, in the future, blockchains that manage and verify online data. Is that a true or a false statement? It's connected in A-Lab with the lowercase and the 5G. So you can put it away again? Yeah. All right, there we go. Of the people that answer true, why do they think or like, willing to answer that? Why do you think that they verify, manage and verify online data?
For example, if you make a technology, blockchain technology in real estate business,
yeah,
and you put data in this technology, you
okay.
can also verify who is the owner of the real estate,
okay.
what was the past.
Okay, I got it. I will repeat it for the rest of the group. So you could, for example, take real estate data and put that on the blockchain so that people can verify the status of or the ownership of that real estate, for example.
Like making real estate operations through blockchain technology, you can verify.
Yeah, okay, good. Thank you. So that's not a wrong idea of working with blockchains. It's simply not true that it's put on the blockchain. Only the proof of real estate would be put on the blockchain. So I'm afraid it's a bit of that kind of stuff. If people say we put data on the blockchain. You don't put anything on the blockchain, only proofs. And what proofs are? We will get to that in 15 minutes.
Contracts. Isn't it a contract? Isn't it a proof?
Sorry?
A contract. Like
a contract.
Example,
no,
that
a contract.
You can sell and buy through blockchain.
A contract is a document that's data. And we don't put that document on the blockchain. We don't do that. But I will show you later what we put on the blockchain.
Isn't a smart contract like Ethereum?
That's something else. Yeah, that's a smart contract. And that's a more or less. That's a, we'll get to that after the cryptography course for 5 minutes. We have a cryptography course. So the last one. Could you push the show image again? So your take on, what's your take on this? They say blockchain store information across network of personal computers.
Okay.
So then you can ask, you can answer these questions there. If you think that blockchain store proofs, not information in general, well, we've done that. At least I was passionately telling you that we only store proofs, but that's an easy one. Personal computers, no way, indeed. We have nowadays to settle transactions on the Bitcoin blockchain, we have like mining farms. These are huge buildings full of computers, and that's only one node, and we have like 7,000 or 8,000 nodes, mostly organized in pools. So you can't mine or validate Bitcoin transactions with a personal computer anymore.
But the nodes validate.
Exactly.
But it says it stores information on personal computers, and that's kind of true. Yeah, I mean, you can run a wallet which is a full node on your computer. It takes up like, I don't know, 30, 40 gigs just to run the wallet, but it's possible if you really want to.
Okay. You think it?
I don't think it's really usable, but it's mm-hmm. It's yeah. Possible.
But the essence is there. I would say these personal computers don't do anything in the decentralized consensus about the blocks. Blockchains duplicate flood data on the network. That is also true. So what? There was a small suggestion in the film that we pick all the data from different parts and put that together, and that's a blockchain. That's not true. All nodes have a full copy of the whole blockchain. Yeah. All full nodes have a copy of the blockchain. So that's true as well. So blockchain store proofs, that's what I wanted to say. Of course, of money, because we have cryptocurrencies, like 700 already. The total market cap of all cryptocurrencies is tiny compared to the total market cap of normal fiat currencies, and especially if you consider the derivatives as well. It's only a tiny spot on the wall, and we are so concerned, all parties are so concerned to regulate that. And we're not looking at the big picture, but only the small dot. We're very much interested. And why are we here? Why are we so interested? Because it's exactly in this void between all the rules and regulations that we have, and there are no specific regulations for this new technology. We can also store, and that was happily, we just discovered it. It was by occasion, by coincidence, that's the right word. It's like Coca-Cola. Coca-Cola was not invented as a soft drink, it was invented as a headache, a painkiller. So it's the same with Bitcoin. It was invented as a money system, but it proved to be able to store proofs of identity, to store proofs of location, of compliance, of existence of the Tzatziki. And I think we can make another sheet, what kind of proofs we can store. So you take any piece of data, and then you go ahead. What we try to do, what the inventor of Bitcoin tried to do, and underneath is the blockchain, we try to cut out the middleman. But we must not forget that he or she, as a middleman, might have an added value in the past. Banks, notaries, insurance companies, charity organizations, they have, of course, some kind of an added value. So if we cut that out, what happens next? Are you really in control? I mean, if you have all your own control over your own cryptocurrency, your crypto value, maybe even stored in your personal identity information, then you have all these keys, and you're a proud owner of these private keys. Are you really in control? Do you know how to manage them? Would you learn more? Would you like to learn more how to manage them? And what about the fact if you age, and your children might want to inherit your value? How do we do that? All these kinds of questions we have to solve now too. How's your privacy enforced? That's something Valeria will elaborate on in a small workshop with each other. What's now I get back to the key of my presentation is we have blockchain technology, which is fairly new, uses a small number of basic crypto building blocks. And we have on the other side identity, which is here for 40, 50 years and has evolved cryptographically over all these years. It's far ahead, cryptographically spoken. And then we have this connection between blockchain and identity, which is very obvious. If you own a Bitcoin, it's your virtual identity. The public key of a Bitcoin is your virtual identity because you control it. If somebody else controls it, it's not your identity anymore. So somebody else can go off with your value there. We have two types of building blocks, symmetric and asymmetric. Symmetric means you have one key, it unlocks a door, and you simply make copies of the key, and you trust the people that have these copies to keep the copy for themselves and unlock the door whenever they want. Okay? But there's more to it, of course. We have more cryptographical... asymmetric is public-private key cryptography, and that's a really smart invention. And we will go into details of that, because you really need to know it. If you don't want to own cryptocurrencies, fair enough. But if you want to be self-sovereign in your identity in the future, be in control of your own identity information, you have to know what asymmetric encryption is, and it will be taught, and that's my expectation. My expectation is that it will be taught in primary school within 10 years, this kind of cryptography. So you're the first to know. We have hashing. We will look into hashing, and there's a film about it, so why should I explain it? Encryption's symmetric. Encryption is a totally different technique than hashing. Encryption means that you hide, you scramble some data. For example, the real estate data, you scramble that so nobody can see the actual content of it. So you scramble it, but it's still there. It's only encrypted. It's something totally different than a hash. A hash is something you make a fingerprint of the data. Okay? We will see on the film next. And there's one last, so we have three. First is hashing, second is encryption. We can do encryption symmetric and asymmetric. And we have digital signing, very important. Digital signing, something totally different than encryption, totally different than hashing. And you think, wow, why should I know of all this kind of, you know? Why should I know it? Because your children will know it within 10 years. It's like 100 years ago, people didn't want to know what a carburetor was or a fuel tank. They didn't need to know because they were riding on horses. But now we have Bitcoin and blockchain, and we have new identity management. And it's all based on these basic parameters, basic building blocks, cryptographically. So please take some time in the coming days to understand these three basic building blocks. So we start with the first one, hashing.
A hash is a one-way function that has multiple uses in blockchain and decentralized systems. All digital media, like documents, movies, or music, address strings of binary digits, ones and zeros. A hash function takes any digital media and runs an algorithm on it to produce a fixed length and unique digital output known as a hash. This fixed length output is normally much smaller than the original input. Every time the same digital media is put through the hash function, it produces the exact same digital output or hash. When even just a single bit of data in the digital media is changed and then put through the hash function, the digital output, the hash, is completely different to the original one. The mathematics behind the hash function ensures that there is no way to derive the original digital media content from its generated hash,
thus making the hash function one-way. In a blockchain, the notion of mining...
So, it's good to have this on the screen, because in blockchain, this hash function, which is a cryptographical building it's used in mining. We don't need to know now. I just want to learn to present you, to you that a hash is a very important building. I want to wrap it up. It's like a fingerprint. You know, you put a fingerprint of some block of data. You can't tell anything about the data that's being from the fingerprint. So it's one way, and it is also sort of a commitment. It's like a sealed envelope, isn't it? I put some data in there, I seal the envelope. So it's a sort of a commitment of me towards anybody that receives this hash, together with the original data, that this data was in my possession at the time that I've made this fingerprint. Okay. So now we are very short distance to blockchain, because if you have this fingerprint and you timestamp that one, and you put it on a blockchain so you can verify it later. But that's it's a sort of a proof. You put it on a blockchain with a timestamp. So if you have this data later, you can again render this hash and compare it, and then you have like immutable proof, uncensorable, open, transparent, etc., etc., etc. But that's a hash. And we get the next one. I need some tools for the next one. So I can mute the screen a bit.
Can I ask a question?
Maybe, but
it's like that the words that go into the hash generator, are these words like the 12 words you give for the user?
It's any name. No, that's not, I mean, with, you mean a seed.
Yeah,
no, that's no value.
It's
just any amount of data, 1 gigabyte, 1 terabyte, it will only produce one single hash of 64 characters, and it's an ugly bastard. But it will be produced every time the same way, even if you do it in 10 years. You need the same software function, but that's open source, so it's available. And you need your eyes to see that they're exactly the same. And you don't need your eyes if there is only one bit changed, because it will produce a totally different fingerprint.
Can you explain the hash generator a little bit more? I mean, who controls it?
Nobody controls it. It's open source. A hash generator is, for example, SHA-265. It's a simple hash or something. I forgot.
Algorithm.
Yeah. So it's open source, and it generates it all the time. It will be here. It was here 20 years ago. It will be here for the rest of our lives.
I think it's important that it's a mathematical algorithm, so it's just math.
Yeah.
Okay.
In that Scala convolution, for whoever knows.
Sorry?
The Scala convolution.
Convolution.
It's used by VH transformation.
Okay.
Yeah, it's the mathematical.
Okay, good. Thank you. So there's no collusion possible, isn't it?
No, and it's not a software, it's actually just math. It's a few you put it into a mathematical function and this rolls out. That's it.
Formula.
Yeah. And nobody owns the plus sign, same like this.
So I will try to get some attention again. So this is a beautiful piece of information, isn't it? So I really want to mesh this up. I want to scramble it so that nobody knows how beautiful this is. So what I do is I use a key. Use this as a key. So I will put it here. I will say, I will lock it up. So for you, I have to do it by that. Okay? I lock it up. And what happens is that it's still there, but it has a different shape. You can see that it's there, but you can't see the real content. You need the key to open it up. So if I give anybody else the key, Now I have two keys, which are exactly the same, and anyone that grabs it can open it up like this, you know? You can open it up. What happens is that it will build up like that for these eyes only. But if these eyes only are so smart to throw it everywhere so everybody can see it. This is symmetric encryption. This is a sort of symmetric encryption. The same key over and over again to lock this information up. It's encryption. Yeah? So we have a piece of information, we scramble it with one key, and we do that symmetrically. It's one key. Okay. But it's got better, I promised it would be better. We have like, we need to have an example of public-private key encryption, because that's invented. It's really smart. And what it does is that you have a public key, which we call, in blockchains, we call it a public address, or public key, unfortunately. So this resembles a public key. It's a house, it has an address, and it's totally transparent, and you can put value in there, but you can't open it. So what we do to, don't need that anymore. What we do to create a key, I go to my cellar and I come up with a public-private key pair. Don't ask me how, but I have it. It's a public-private key pair. So this is the address, and this is the key again. Private key, public key. This house now has an address. So I have to be very careful with this key, because it's my identity. If I'm uncautious or not prudent working with this key, I would lose it. If somebody photographs my key, I've lost it. If somebody has 10 seconds access to my computer, I will lose my key. So this is what we've got back for all this freedom, from being able to transfer value from A to B without any third party, is that we have to be aware that it can go wrong all the time. But what are the advantages? There are a lot of advantages. Okay, who can catch? Yep. Yep. There, over there. So now we have more people know my public key. They know the address of my house. So now they could come in and put something in this very interesting box, like euros or whatever, or a contract, or real estate contract. They could put it in here and actually combine that information, or that proof of the contract, that proof of the money, proof of any sort of location or compliance. They could put it on my public address. Well, it's a sort of an analogy, and I know people that know a lot about blockchains will find gaps in my reasoning, but for the time being, just try to stay with me, because we have information here. So there's interesting proofs in the possession of the people that have these public keys over here. So you can take it there. So you can take some information as well. Yeah, okay, good. Now what I could do is, of course, in a connected world, in the internet connected world, we don't have like a public key here and the same public key over there. It's all connected. It's like Avatar, the film Avatar. Everything is connected. So if they put something on this public key, if you want to stick it to the, yeah, okay. So now they put something on my public key, there's a proof. Present there on YouTube, you have done it too?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. And I could simply come and use these avatar-like connections to just collect it.
Oh, okay.
I will give it to mine. All right, thank you. So, I put this away. It's on this, but I'm the only one that can take it away. So I could grab it like this. That's the whole idea of public-private key interaction. There's one step we need more, because this is what we need to understand, is that digital signing means that I want to trust somebody. Remember, it's all about legal here. So we continue with legal, and we are very low in the cryptography now, but we want to crawl out of this hole and start to talk about legal. And what happens here is that I collected proofs, or I collected money from people, but I don't have the faintest idea who they are. You know? And there's somebody that really wants to know that you know who you collect money from. That's, for example, the SEC, or the Fiat, or the AML. And they have AML rules and KYC. So how do we now protect myself? How could I protect myself to collect value, proofs of value, and also know, be sure that this value came from these two guys over there? And that's digital signing. And he pops up. Got a new private key made in my cellar. No, you made it in your cellar over there. So you made a public private key pair there. So there you got it. Yeah, I collect that one back. So you have your private key, it's a green one. And the public key is a blue one. I have that blue public key. What's a feature of a public-private key pair? So the cryptographical invention is that if she signs this very value, this proof, she signs it with a green private key, then I can come over again.
Very active.
Yeah, very active, yeah. Especially from my part. So
transaction fee.
Somebody is very
you have time
yeah, 40. Yeah. I started at 10, so we'll finish this one. So she signed it with her private key, and the good thing about public private key cryptography is that I can prove that she signed it with her public key. And that's a really interesting feature. Because now we have the proof on the blockchain, and we have it signed by her. So these basic building blocks are all over identity management and blockchains. And you just have to go and look for them. It's a confusing journey, because it took me like 3 months to distinguish them all the time. And I make many mistakes on them. I can't answer questions now, because otherwise he will be in my neck.
Yep.
I'm pretty tough. So we did this with the blocks. We went through them. You can have a look at encryption. It's a funny film. We can start it in the during the break. Okay. Oh, you blocked the screen. That's a way of getting me out. So, this is a small wrap up. It's so you can verify later, and you need the real or original data to be able to do that. So you can't put any data on the blockchain. That's not correct. You put the proof on the blockchain, so you can verify it later, having the same data. Okay. So, that's where we are. Next one. Smart contracts, just a small introduction, because we have speakers, have they arrived already?
Yes.
Yeah, okay, there you are. Good. We have a speaker later on legal applications of the blockchain. That's something totally different than legal aspects of the blockchain. So what we have here is smart contracts, and you can use them to automate operations on a blockchain. Smart contracts that this gentleman mentioned before, they are residing on the blockchain as well. You can't go into detail, but they are immutable and they are uncensorable, but they could be faulty. There can be faults in there. So because this doesn't necessarily be have to be a smart contract, because I might lose my coins if I put them in. It could block. It could fall through, and I don't receive any gun, etc. Okay. Last slide is the introduction of what BUS is going to do after the workshop of identity, and just an introduction of what is an ICO. Please enter. Yeah. Have a seat somewhere. What is an ICO? It's people with an by people done by people with an idea, and they obviously need money, and they want it from you, and they want it. In large amounts, and they want you to be silly and just pay, right? So if you do that, they will be happy. And how can they do that? They create a token on a blockchain. They use that. They use smart contracts for that. And you can buy it via a website and an exchange. So you go to a website, but you also have to change your fiat currency into some sort of cryptocurrency. That cryptocurrency you can spend on a new coin which is being released, is initially coin offered. That was my introduction, and it's at least 5 minutes.
Thank you for wrapping up.